Thank you. Oh boy. Awwwards, thank you for having me today. I'm very excited to be standing in the middle amongst such like-minded creatives. Today I want to share my my insights, observations, and thoughts around anticipated experiences. For the last couple of years, I dove into the world of machine learning predictive user experiences and also looked at how users feel about their experience being automated. How do they feel about, you know, privacy, about free will and stuff. But first, let's talk about my biggest passion, and that is the UX of AI. And I think there are a lot of people here in the room who have like the same interest and also are looking for new ways of creating great seamless and also meaningful experiences. First, I'd like to introduce myself a bit because I think a lot of you never heard of me. I'm a product designer at TravelBird. TravelBird is a Dutch skill-up that focuses on inspiring traveling, inspiring holidays, and I'm also an Hyper Island alumni. I've studied digital experience design at the University of Hyper Island. And today, the biggest topic and the biggest problem what started my research was choice. And choice stems specifically from the noisy world we are currently living in. I mean, we get all those notifications, Slack messages, we are just overloaded with all kinds of stimuli, and our brains are simply not used to this information. So, they say that we have like, that we make 35,000 decisions a day, consciously and subconsciously. Now, this number is quite old. I think it's 2-3 years ago, and there was a bit before the Slack era, so I think it's now 100,000 plus. And a lot of people think, you know, choice is good. I mean, choice is freedom. If a user has choice, he can do whatever he wants. But in the end, we all know, like this picture, choice can be also very painful, right? I mean, at the end of the day, you are tired, you've done your job, you're going to work, and you go through by the grocery store, and then you end up in such an alley, and then you're like, okay, let's just grab a pizza and move. So choice can also be painful. And I'd like to mention Barry Schwartz in this case. He wrote The Paradox of Choice. I would recommend that read. And he said, choice can be painful because it can lead to paralysis. And that is like the grocery store scenario at which you have so many options that you're like, okay, I don't know, I picked the easiest option. It can also lead to anticipated regret. So what if I pick that meal or pick that piece of bread? And in hindsight, I think, okay, but maybe the other one was better. And that ultimately leads to self-blame. So I think choice is overrated. And I also think that with the current state of technology and the current state of machine learning and AI, we can predict and anticipate a lot if you think of those choices. So that's why anticipatory design is a really interesting design pattern in the field of predictive user experiences. Because anticipatory design is all about design that's one step ahead. It's firstly coined by Aaron Shapiro from Huge, and I picked this up as a research topic because I'm just very excited about this and I just want to ideate more on it and create meaningful anticipatory experiences. So if you look at the conceptual framework, anticipatory design moves basically around learning, predicting, and anticipating. So via IoT devices, your environment surrounding learn from your patterns, and machine learning makes sense of the data, and we as UX designers create systems and services that really meaningful anticipate the next step for the user. So it's all about from help me make decisions, what is currently the status quo with apps, for make decisions for me. So it's eliminating choice. And if you look at examples of anticipatory design, because anticipatory design is not new or something. I mean, design in general is anticipatory because we anticipate on users' needs. You know, we are problem solvers. But if you look at current examples, it's mainly in software. So navigation, Spotify that anticipates on your music choice. Tesla, of course, that anticipate on the surroundings. Nest, that knows when you're home and knows when you're gone, and yeah, set the temperature just on the right temperature and the right time. And of course, the Apple Watch, which is also very handy. It keeps you just simply in the loop. But there's just one game changer or game changers. The smart personal assistants. And the interesting fact is that products like Google Home, for example, get adapted more and more. And we have like a generational shift at which we have more like tech-savvy people who really like these products and really use them. Google recently also released some interesting data about this. And as you can see is that products like these get a far more prominent place in their home and lives, and I think that will continue to grow. At TravelBird, our goal is to deliver stress-free and hassle-free holidays. Because if you are going on holiday, you want to be in the moment. You want to, you already have like a really busy life, so you want to just jump in a plane and don't stress about anything. And I can tell, trips and holidays are stressful because when I arrived in Berlin, Tegel can be quite stressful, I can say. And with our design team and our development team, we try to map the whole flow and the whole experience map and try to deliver the right information, the right time, because a lot of stress comes from uncertainty and not knowing what's up next, and that's a quite easy step and a quite easy thing to anticipate on. So, for example, the day before, we all know the moment that you think, oh yeah, shit, I need to check in, or what gate does my plane leave, or what time do I leave? So we try to come up with like a notification system that brings you like in your trip summary, so you can easily read the whole summary and see what's up next, and that will reduce the stress. Another thing is at the airport. I mean, I'm from Amsterdam, so Schiphol can be like one big maze. A well-designed maze, I must say, but still you have like that uncertainty of like the gate information, is my plane delayed or not, etc. So we try to anticipate that by also showing if you arrive at the hotel, we know your GPS location, it pops up, and you know what's up next. And of course, when you arrive, at the next destination, especially if you've never visited, you want to know, okay, what are the directions to my hotel? Can I get there as fast? And maybe, we can offer an Uber drive to make that experience a bit better. It's all focused on removing the stress, but also eliminating unnecessary decisions. Then we have the hotel. So if you look at hotels or accommodations, you have a lot of expectations. And from our experience, if you arrive at the accommodation and you see that it's rubbish, then you want to give feedback on something and you want to be helped and get help. So we trigger like this notification, if it works, yeah. Oh. So we trigger this notification if they arrive at the hotel so they can give immediately feedback to us. I hope it's gonna work now. Yeah, that's gonna, sorry. So as you can see here, we know also based on the GPS location that the person is in the hotel and they can immediately give like a star rating. So do you like the experience or do you don't like the experience? Sorry for the Dutch, by the way. And if it's a bad experience, they can send their comments and we immediately call them back. So they feel at least heard. So that is a short example of what we try to do at TravelBird. But this is all app related and it's all quite safe. And my dream would be like a future without choice. I mean, a future without unnecessary choice. And that was also the topic for my master's research, to check in with industry leaders, to check in with companies, to check in with users, how they feel about this seamless anticipated experience. And I'm gonna share now the findings and the ethical challenges, because there are quite some. So what people like about it is that there are less decisions, right? So everything is anticipated and you're just, you know, rolling. It's a seamless experience, and that's why you can focus on stuff you really like and stuff that really matter. But the downside is that you have no privacy, because in order for us to anticipate your experience, we need to know everything of you. I mean, it's not like 90%, but you need to give like the 100%, because otherwise we provide the bad choices or not just right. So there's a tension over there. Then the experience bubble. So Eli Pariser talked about a filter bubble at which you stay in your own online reality. And a lot of people were worried about, yeah, but what if, you know, systems anticipate my movement and suggest actions, and that I, without me knowing it, stay in the same loop without ever having the opportunity to discover new things. And then we have alienation of human capabilities. This point came from the experts that I spoke with. One was from Xerox PARC, and he said there's a danger in, you know, putting everything into an algorithm or a system, because then we forget maybe what the meaning and true purpose is behind the actions we did and we now automate. So there's also like, there's always a purpose and a value in doing things and knowing why we do stuff. Another important thing about the ethics is that there's a lot of design ethics involved if you design anticipated experiences. And one of the things that is, I think, the most important change is how we set up creative teams. So now it's more, in most companies, it's like designers and engineers. But I think that we should be more focused on the new team building, because machine learning is also a creative process in this regard. I have six, based on the research I did, I have six design considerations for you. The first one is design with purpose. So what you also see is that a lot of design practices are around machine learning are based on, you know, making machines smarter, building great features and such, but sometimes we forget the real purpose, problem solving. So find a real, focus on like a real human need and focus on and look at how you can augment that. the user is always in control. So some people, like me, I guess, find it really nice and interesting to have you all day automated and anticipated. But a lot of people really value of being in control. And I think one of the important things here is to have like a switch off button at which people can go on manual mode or something and really stay in control of their own experience. Design against the experience bubble. So in this case, I think the sense of discovery is the most important thing, because if everything is anticipated and everyone is predicting everything for you, then you lose your sense of curiosity. And I think that is one of the most important things that makes us strive for more. And then humanize experiences. So I showed to you the Google Home, and one of the things that stand out to me is that they lack personality, the monotone voices, the bad jokes. And if you look, for example, at the movie Her, who have seen the movie Her? Any hands? Oh. If you've not seen it, go see it. I think personality is more important in the future than the amount of gigabytes on your phone or how fast a computer is. The relationship with technology will change in a way that we really gonna care on our device, and I don't know in what form, but it will get more close. So investing in a personality or an identity that you can relate on is an interesting consideration. And then hierarchy. So imagine this: you are at home and you have a nest, and your wife wants the temperature on 20 degrees and you want 21. Who's the super user and who's gonna decide? Nest is quite safe because it's only temperature, but what if you have a more a more immersive experience or more high impact experience? It's interesting to think of, but there should be a sort of hierarchy. Bless you. I think tossing coins wouldn't be the option, but it's an interesting thing to think about. And this is the last design consideration. The best interface is no interface. So still, I hear a lot of people say, oh, yeah, let's build an app. And I mean, I love apps. But if you truly want to anticipate, then I think you also should, and you want to focus on, you know, remove decisions, then you also should remove the interface, because if you open some interfaces, you're like, holy shit, what's next, you know? So if technology, if my mobile phone knows everything for me, he shouldn't offer me an interface, he should offer me a question or a solution. So after my research, I started anticipatorydesign.com. It's like a sort of movement to collect all kinds of insights and to also keep the conversation going, because I think we are just at the beginning of this era, and I think it can be the biggest leap in UX to date. And I want to ask you to also join the movement and collaborate and share thoughts on this, because I think the conversation and the discussion within the design community is the most important thing, because there we get the best out of it. Thank you for your attention and have a nice day.